Live. So good morning, everyone. My name is Jesse, and I am with Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants. For those joining us for the first time, we are all about bringing conservation, adventure, and science into classrooms around the world. And we are so excited because today we have some live groups joining at home. So we are joined by Bennett, Tegan, Becca, and Brandy from Festus, Missouri, Alexandria, Virginia, Lake Country, BC, and Elora, Ontario today. So we're going to introduce them a little later, say hi, and take some questions from some live families at home. Today, we continue our epic Toronto Zoo series. So every single Tuesday and Thursday at 11 a.m. Eastern, we have been featuring amazing stories from around the zoo. So last week, we finished off in the Americas Pavilion, learning about some really cool land animals. Well, today we are back, and we are going to learn about movement in the water for some really cool creatures. A few quick notes before we dive in. In addition to typing in questions on our YouTube chat bar, you can also use our Slido app. So I'll link this in the chat bar in a minute. But if you use the event code WATER on Slido, you can ask questions, upvote your favorites, take part in some quizzes and games. I encourage you to do so. It's a lot of fun. But without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Sean at the Toronto Zoo. Thanks so much for joining us today and take us away. Let me just demute your mic. Go for it.
All right. Hi, everyone. Welcome back to the Toronto Zoo. Just to let everybody know, the zoo is closed, but we are still taking care of all of our animals every single day. In fact, I have my gloves on because I just came from taking care of a few animals myself. Like Jesse said, today we're going to continue our episodes by going through the Americas area again, except we're going to go to the areas that we skipped over on our last week's episode. We're going to talk more about the aquatic animals, and in particular, how do aquatic animals move around in their watery habitats. So before we get going here, what we want to do is every single time we have a riddle that we want you to try and figure out. I'm going to hold the riddle up here, and the first person to be able to answer that online will get a shout out at the end of the entire episode. So here's your clue for today. Hopefully you can see that. I may have eyes, but that's just one way to see. This adaptation is just one of the differences between you and me. Detect habit. So I'll give you a minute to read that, and I'll just let you know that the answer is not a kind of animal. It's an adaptation that an animal probably has. All right, so let's go and see what we can find down here in our aquatic area of the Americas habitat. So the first animal we're going to go and look at is an animal that actually can't move that well. So we're going to come down here and check out one of the anemones. So this is an anemone. An anemone might look like a plant, but it's actually an animal. And what's neat about them is they live in the marine habitats and they don't move a lot because they have this really, really big foot on the bottom of them that sticks really well to whatever they're trying to hold on to, which is usually rocks or the ground or in coral reef or something like that. So an anemone is a filter feeder. They like to just stay still and let things come past them. So they don't really have to move all that often. When they're very young, they might float around in the water until they find something they want to land on. And then they'll stick their foot to it really, really hard like that. It's really hard to pull an anemone off of a structure once it's attached. So once it's attached like that, it has these little tentacles that stick out around the top of itself. And it can wave the tentacles around and catch food that happens to come by. And every time that the tentacles catch something, they'll actually pull it to the center where the mouth is. And you can see that it has a little mouth in the back there. So when they pull things towards their mouth, they'll pull food, but they'll also pull other things that happen to float by. And then everything gets put inside. And then the anemone figures out which stuff is waste and which stuff is food. It digests its food. And then once that's done, all the waste gets blown back out the same opening that came in. So what that means in the anemone world is your mouth is also your butt. They only have one opening. So everything that goes in comes out the same hole. So this is an animal that stays still. If an anemone needs to move, say there's nothing good about the area that it's in or its food source is depleted, it can unattach its foot, but then it's at the mercy of the tides. So it will get blown wherever it gets blown. And sometimes they get blown onto things that keep moving. So it has been seen that you'll find anemones attached to sea turtle shells or to the shells of crabs sometimes, if they're small enough to stick on there. So let's go one step up from the anemone and we'll go over another tank here and we can see our starfish. So obviously they're called starfish because they're shaped like a star and they are not sessile. That's the term being still all the time. They can't because they don't move very fast. the way that they move is they have all these little tiny feet. Instead of one big foot, they have a whole bunch of little tiny feet that look like suckers, and they'll move them one at a time. They pull themselves across the floor of the ocean or across the rocks. They can stick pretty much anything they have to, whenever they want to. So they'll move along, and then if they walk over top of something that tastes good so they can taste with their feet, then they'll stop and they'll start to eat. And those little tiny feet will push the food to the center. So in the very center of the starfish is a mouth, except they're a little more advanced than the anemone. Instead of having a one hole that everything comes in and everything comes back out, they do have a different hole that stuff comes out of. So if you look at the one in the back, and I'm going to describe what you're looking for is called a madreporite. The madreporite is where all the waste gets expelled out of the starfish after it's done eating. And it's if you look just in the center and to the bottom a wee bit, you can see that kind of crevice shape. So that can open up, and that's where all of the waste comes out. So that's a little bit more advanced than the anemone are. So if you come here and you see the starfish, the next time you come to the American Pavilion, you'll want to have to sit for a long time to actually see them move. They move very, very slowly. In fact, when science tries to study starfish in the wild, they have to use stop motion cameras just to speed the film up fast enough to be able to see them moving across the bottom of the ocean. Now, in this tank is another creature that's hiding very well. It has the same starfish, but a lot faster, and that's our octopus. So our octopus is hiding up there in the corner, but they have suckers on their feet as well. So octopus is Latin for 8 feet. So an octopus, octo, 8 feet, or pus means foot. And so they have 8 legs. And each one of those legs has a whole bunch of suckers on it. And the octopus can fold its legs out and grab hold of whatever it needs to and pull itself along. You can see that it's kind of manipulating its toy ball there too. So they can, whenever they find something, they can wrap their suckers and their leg around it and pull it back towards their mouth. A different thing from the starfish is that the octopus does have a hard mouth. It has a beak like a bird. And the reason is because it wants to be able to crack open shells. So if it catches a clam, for instance, it can crack the shell open and pull all the stuff that it wants from inside out. Now, they use their suckers to move along the bottom so they can pull themselves along just like a starfish, but they can also swim. So an octopus has the ability to swim by jet propulsion, believe it or not. You can see them breathing right now. So you can see that every time it takes a breath in and out, you can see water being pumped in and out of its siphon. So it has a hole on each side of its body that sucks the water in and then pushes the water out. And that's the same as me and you breathing. So when me and you are breathing right now, we're very relaxed and we're just breathing in and out nice and easy. But if the octopus wants to get away or move really quickly, it can jet the air, the water out of its siphons really quickly. You can try this at home right now. If you take your hand and just hold it in front of your mouth while you're breathing nice and slow in and out and relaxed, you can just barely feel your breath coming out of your mouth. Well, what I want you to do is take a big breath in and then breathe out as fast as you can really hard on your hand. You'll feel all that air hit against your hand really hard. Well, the octopus does the same thing with water. It'll take a big inhale of a lot of water, and then it can shoot it out through its siphon and jet propulsion shoot itself through the water, which is really, really neat. It can do it really quickly. The only problem with jet propulsion is once you do that, you can only go in a straight line. So if anything was chasing after the octopus, it can't really dodge back and forth to try and get away, because as soon as it puts one of its tentacles out to try and stop itself, it'll immediately slow down. So it's a lot more advanced than just crawling across the bottom, but it does have its disadvantages. There's one way of beating that, though, and we're going to go and check out the next animal down here to see the most advanced version of getting around in the water. These are red-breasted piranha. So piranha are a beautiful example of fish and a beautiful example of the ability to swim in water using fins. So you can see when you look at pretty much any fish that they have fins that are on every side of their body except for their face. So their tail, the sides of their body, the bottom of their body, and the top of their body. And all these fins work to help move the fish in any direction that it wants to go. So instead of jet propulsion, where you only go forward because there's only one direction of movement, they can move their fins in different ways to be able to move in any direction they really want to. Fish can even swim upside down. They don't tend to want to do it, but they can if they really have to. So the piranha will swim around, and it helps them to swim around because it helps them breathe as well. You'll see that they swim with their mouths open, And as they swim, they let water come through their mouth and goes through their gills, and that helps them to breathe. So the constant motion like that. But they can also open and close their mouth to pull the water through to breathe as well and get the oxygen out of the water. So something else you'll notice about the piranha is that they have a very wide body. And that's because piranha live in areas like in rivers where there's a lot of things like sticks and other stuff that's in the way. And they have to be able to get around those things quickly to find the food that they want. Piranha will eat usually other fish, but if they find something that died in the water, so it's something much larger than them that happened to die, like a turtle, then they can also eat that as well. And they do that because piranha are special and have very, very large teeth in their mouth that are very, very sharp. The red-breasted piranha doesn't have the biggest teeth. The black piranhas have bigger teeth, but these guys have some serious teeth in there as well. You're probably wondering if you stick your hand in there, would they try and eat your hand? And more often than not, the answer is no, because piranha are just the same as any other animal. If they see something that's big and strange and scary, they'll tend to just get away from it as fast as possible. So swimming with fins has got to be the most adapted way of getting around in the water. And so popular that you see almost all fish now use fins in this kind of format to get around. Some of the older type of fish have different types of fins, like you saw with the eel before last week. And that's also a type of fin, but it's a little bit different from having fins on all sides of your bodies. Now, there's something on this fish that you may be able to see. It's a little bit hard to see on these guys, but we're going to go and find another special type of fish that has this unique adaptation. We can see a little bit better. So we're going to travel a wee bit here, Jesse. So if you want to take over, we're going to go to our next area.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, thank you so much for the awesome animals so far. And as we're walking to the next section of the exhibit, I just want to highlight again for people at home that we have done a variety of sessions with the Toronto Zoo, some of our most popular sessions ever. So if you want to check out our YouTube page, they're all there, from giraffes to tree kangaroos, Komodo dragons, and more. And we'll be doing another one this Thursday at 11 a.m. Eastern that you can tune in on. For people at home or tuning in on YouTube, just check out the fact that we're welcoming in live families now, classrooms, educators, and more. So we encourage you to get some live camera spots and sign up for our events on our website. For those who aren't on Slido yet, event code WATER, you can type in questions, take part in a quiz happening at the end of the program too. And we still haven't had a correct answer to the riddle, so I look very forward to that. But I think we're back with Sean. We're going to explore some more cool fish.
All right. So here we are, we're in a different area of the Americas Pavilion right now. What we're looking at are blind cavefish. If you look closely at them, if they stay still for you, you'll notice that they do not have eyes. So that is really cool. Now, they don't have eyes because they don't need them. Where these fish live, they're in dark caves where the sunlight never shines. So if there's no light and there's nothing to see, there's no need to have an eyeball to be able to see it. But one thing you can see a little bit better on these animals is you'll see the dark line down their body, going from one end of the, from their gills basically down to the end of their tail. And what that line is the lateral line. Almost all fish have this lateral line. And what it is, it's actually a groove. Just like if you look at the palm of your hand, you can see the different lines in the palm of your hand. Those are little grooves, skin grooves. That's a groove down the side of the fish as well. And inside that groove is a whole bunch of microscopic tiny little hairs. And whenever the water moves around the fish, those tiny little hairs can pick up any little tiny movement that happens to be around the fish. The stronger the vibrations that come through the water, the more that those hairs can pick up the movement. And so what happens is when the fish moves, it sends out reverberations through the water and then it bounces back to them. And they can basically feel where everything is in the water. That's why while you're watching these fish, you notice they don't bump into anything. Running into the glass or the walls or the rocks or any of the plant life in here whatsoever, even though they don't have any eyes. So that's because they have a lateral line. You can test this out yourself later on if you want to. And what you do is just walk up close to about an arm's length to a wall and then close your eyes and start to hum. And keep humming while you get closer and closer and closer to that wall. And eventually you'll be able to tell if you walk slow enough whether you're getting close to the wall or not, because the sound will change. That's exactly how the lateral line works with these animals as well. So almost all fish will have it. Some will be really easy to see. Some won't be so easy to see like on the piranha. But if you look hard enough, you'll be able to figure it out.
So we've seen fish, we've seen the invertebrates, but there's other animals like mammals, like us, that go and swim in the waters as well. So we're going to go over and check out them. So we're going to go for a little walk again. Jesse, if you want to cut back.
All right. While we're walking up to the next exhibit, too, I want to mention that a few people on YouTube and someone who's joining live got our riddle answer, so we'll reveal that at the end. That's awesome, guys. All right.
They're in there, but I don't know if it's here or not. We're going to try and see if we can see our beavers. It's kind of dark in there, so we might be able to get close enough.
Oh, and look at that. They're sleeping with their best buddy, the snapping turtle. So there's two beavers in there and a snapping turtle.
All cuddled up and cozy.
Isn't that cute?
So beavers are an aquatic animal. They are really adapted for swimming as well. When you come to the zoo and see them active, which is usually around or in the fall when they're trying to gather up enough food for the wintertime, they have really big webbed feet. So their feet, when they push them through the water, will spread open, and that's enough to push them forward. Their front feet don't have any webbing. It's just their back feet, and that's because they use their front feet for grabbing hold of things or for digging. They don't really push themselves through the water with their front feet, just their back feet. Now, you might think a beaver has a big flat tail. Maybe that's what helps it to swim as well, but they don't actually use their tail for swimming. Where their tail attaches to their body is a really thin, so it's not very strong, not like the rest of the size of the tail, so they can't really use it to push themselves through the water like an alligator would. They usually just use their tail kind of like a rudder, so when they want to turn really quick, they can use their tail to help turn really quick. Otherwise, the other thing that they'll use their tail for is if they find something that's threatening them, they can slap it on the top of the water and make a big noise, which will scare away the predators. So when the beavers go swimming, you'll notice they're a lot like the otters. They have a long tubular-shaped body, the same as most of the fish as well, and that's because it helps them to get through the water easier. It's called, the form is called fusiform, and that long torpedo shape, or the longer, being longer than you are wider, helps to get through water very easily. An animal like myself and yourself, no deer, you'll usually see them, or you'll know for yourself when you get into the water, you can thrash around as much as you want. You'll never swim as fast as a beaver. So we'll go down and we'll check out a few more fish, because something else that's neat about the beaver and a lot of other animals that aren't fish is that they have a hard time floating or sinking. It's either one or the other, and fish don't seem to have that problem. They're able to just stay wherever they want in the water column whenever they want to. So we can see all these fish here, they not having a problem. They can totally up to them, whatever they want to do. And the reason is because they have a special adaptation called a swim bladder. So inside the middle of the fish, near the top, not near the bottom, they have a
you cut out for a second, Sean.
Yeah.
Sorry about that. You just cut out for a second. You were telling us about the fish.
Yeah, so their swim bladder is inside their body, and they can squeeze it, and that will make the air concentrate and get denser, and so they can sink down a little more, or they can expand their swim bladder and let the air inside get more expanded out, and that will help them to float up. So just like me and you can move our arms and not really have to think about it all that much, they can move their swim bladder and not really think about it that much. So really, a fish can swim anywhere it wants to, whenever it wants to. So those are our adaptations for living in aquatic habitats. And we can keep filming the fish right now. The turtles are swimming around. You can watch the turtles too, and we can take any questions that you guys have.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much, Sean. The connection is the worst that it's been here, so we might want to move a little bit away just when we take questions and have you in the frame, if that's okay. But yes,
we can go and check out the otters.
Perfect. Let's go check out the otters. So while you guys are doing that, again, we've got our biggest group on Slido. I'm going to launch the quiz on Slido in just a second for people tuning in. So thank you for that. Jacob was our riddle winner today. He got lateral line on YouTube before anyone else, and Tegan got it among our live viewers. congratulations to you guys for getting out of our line as our we will take some questions. I'm going to start actually with Tegan, for getting it correct. Tegan, if you want to kick us off live from Lake Country in BC, come on up.
Hey.
Hi.
My question was, when sperm whales migrate, where do they go and where are they coming from?
When which animal migrates?
Sperm whales.
Sperm whales.
Oh, when sperm whales migrate? Okay, sure. When whales migrate, typically what they do is they go from, not so much north or south or east or west, they'll go from where the food is good to where the food gets all used up to another area where the food is good again. And then for the females, what the females will do is they'll go from where they live normally to a place what's just called a calving area. So that's where they go to give birth, because they know that this is the best place to get the most food. And so they'll stay there so that they can produce the most milk for their babies. So they have seasons, and the season has to do with the way that the currents move all the food that they eat. So something like a sperm whale, which is eating squid, it's going to follow where the migrations of squid go. So the sperm whale migrates along with the squid wherever the squid goes. And so sometimes that means going very, very deep down as well, not just going left or right or north or south, but also up and down.
Fantastic. All right. For our live viewers, if you guys want to put up your hands literally, and then I can take questions from you guys, whoever wants questions, let's go to Bennett and check out what he has to ask. Hey, Bennett, welcome in. Hi.
Hi.
Squids actually have battles. If the sperm whale is trying to eat a squid, they have battles.
Yeah. I like how we've gone on the sperm whale kick. So do sperm whales and giant squids have battles? I'm excited.
Well, they certainly can have battles. A giant squid, some of them can get well over 6 meters long, so they can get enormous. Those are usually the ones we never see because they spend most of their time very, very deep in the ocean. They're very hard to find. So a sperm whale will get in a battle with large squid if it has to, but you have to remember that a sperm whale has a giant mouth full of teeth. So I imagine that the sperm whale is probably going to win in the end.
Very cool. All right. Kara on our Slido app wants to know, do starfish have gills?
Starfish don't have gills. They just have, they can absorb most of their oxygen through their skin. And something like gills is a little bit more advanced for the invertebrates to have. They don't usually pump the water actively in and out of themselves. It's just staying in the water. They can absorb and diffuse basically oxygen across the surface of their skin. They don't really have to be pumping air in and out of themselves because they move so slowly and they just live so slowly that they don't use their oxygen up as fast as a fish would.
Cool. Thanks so much, Sean. All right, let's go to Becca's group joining us in Alexandria in Virginia. Hi, guys. Let's just unmute your mic there and, go for it with a question.
How do turtles swim?
Well, let's come over here and take a look. Maybe we can catch a turtle swimming right now. There we go, there's a turtle swimming right there. So a turtle swims the same way that the beaver does. It has webbed feet, so you can look at the back feet there, you can see that they're webbed, and that helps them to push themselves through the water. They don't have webbing on their front toes. Some turtles do, but these guys don't. And that's because, again, they use their front toes for digging. But they can push themselves through the water with their back webbed feet.
Very cool, all right. I'm going to do a shout out to Ireland, who's six, who's been joining us for a huge number of our programs on YouTube. And she wants to know if snapping turtles only snap when they're threatened, or do they snap other animals when they're not threatened?
Yeah, snapping turtles will save their snapping for eating most of the time. But they've figured out it's a really, really good defense. If you were to find a snapping turtle in the wild, usually when you find them is in the springtime, when they start to move from one pond to another, because once the ice melts on the pond, then they'll come out of them and start to move from one to the other to go and find new habitats. So usually when you see a snapping turtle in the wild, usually in the wild, it's on the sides of roads where they're trying to cross over the road to get to the pond on the other side. And when they're on land, that's when they feel the most vulnerable. That's when they think that they're the most scared. So that's when they become the most aggressive, because they are just out of their element. When they're in the water, they usually, if they see you coming along, will just move away from you. They can move a lot faster than we can in the water. But when they're out of the water, yes, they can bite you for sure. But most of the time, they save their snapping for eating their food.
Very cool. All right. Let's head to Maple Creek for Ashley. Do you guys have a question at home?
No.
No? That's okay. We can come back. You can put up your hand if you do have any questions. No worries. Let's go to Callista's group joining us in Mesa. Hi, guys. Let's just unmute your mic. You might need to unmute your own mic. It's not letting me do that. So there you go. Good to go. Hi. Do you have a question for us at the zoo?
No.
No? Okay. We can go back. No worries, guys. You're shy. So feel free to put up your hands for anyone who does have questions. Genevieve in Oshawa on Slido wants to know, do all fish swim with their mouths open, Sean?
Not all fish do. Some of them can close their mouths when they're swimming, but most of them will try to, because by swimming with your mouth open, it's a lot easier to just let the water pass over your gills. But there's you have to think about when a fish stops moving and just sits still. If, for instance, when they rest, when they go through basically what they do the same as us sleeping, when they stop and stay still, they still have to get the water to move across their gills. So at that point in time, that's when they'll usually start to open and close their mouth, and that just pulls the water in and pushes it over their gills as they do that. There's some fish that can't do that, like sharks. So some species of sharks have to almost constantly be swimming in a forward motion to keep the oxygen going into their gills.
Awesome. Very cool. We've been covering that with some of our aquarium sessions too, so I'm glad we got that brought up. All right, looks like Callista does have a question now, so come on up and go for it.
What's the biggest animal you have in the Toronto Zoo?
Probably the largest animal we have here right now is our white rhinos. So they can be upwards of almost 4,000 pounds.
Awesome. Very cool. All right. I want to take a question from YouTube, and then I'm going to come back to each of the kids in turn. So you guys can put your hands down. I'll come to all of you. Hurts your arm, I know. So Kamal, the SDG Warriors teacher, also joining us for a bunch of our sessions, wants to know, what is the most amazing adaptive feature in octopuses?
The most amazing thing about the octopus is probably their intelligence. Octopus is one of the smartest animals that you're ever going to find. In fact, the tank that they exist in here at the zoo and a lot of different other places has to be made really, really secure, because an octopus is very curious, number one, about its environment. It's always searching with all eight legs to try and figure everything out. And eventually it's going to figure out how to escape from its exhibit a lot of the times. And the reason is because, you know, it just wants to look around. It wants to see what else is out there and is very curious. So their intelligence is very, very high. You have to think that it has to be high because for me and you, we have two legs and we have two arms, and we have to always be moving them. That takes a lot of intelligence to be able to do that. So now imagine you had four more on top of that. So if you had eight limbs and all eight limbs are doing something different, you have to have the mental capacity to be able to control all eight limbs all the time. So that makes them very, very intelligent to have to, you know, to do that. On top of it, they have to look at their environment. They have to see what color their environment is and what's the texture of their environment. And then they can change the shape of their skin, the color of their skin, to blend in with that. So if you can imagine having to know what you're sitting next to like this, and then I don't have to try and make sure that my skin appears as if it's the same as the glass with the green color. All that thought process all the time. That's an incredible adaptation.
Super cool. All right. We're going to take about 5-6 more questions now, Sean. I'm going to start by going back to Tegan. If you want to come up with a question, go for it.
How long can beavers hold their breath for, and does the depth affect it?
Yeah, sure. Otters and beavers are pretty similar when they're holding their breath. It's roughly about 3, 4, 5 minutes at a time. Beavers are a little bit better at it because they swim slower, so they don't burn their oxygen up as fast. The reason they can do that and stay underwater a little bit longer than we can is because they can shut down some of the parts of their body that they're not using at that moment in time. So, for instance, if a beaver is going to stay under the water for a very long time, it can turn off its digestive system. It doesn't have to use its digestive system and doesn't have to give it as much oxygen as it has to give to its brain and its heart and its lungs. The lower in the water you go, so if you're up top of the water, there's not a lot of water pushing on you, so you don't have to worry too much about holding your breath here. But as you go down in the water column and get lower, all the weight of all that water starts to press on you, and it presses on all the organs inside you as well. So it will push on your lungs and make your lungs smaller, which means you have less oxygen, and it's harder to hold your breath for longer. So the lower in the water that the something like a beaver or ourselves go, the harder it is to hold your breath.
Fantastic. Thanks, John. All right. Let's go to Becca's group. If you guys have a question, come on up.
How many, what kinds of fishes have teeth?
Oh, lots of fish have teeth. Probably, I wouldn't even know how many different types of fish have teeth, but they probably at least half of them have teeth. The ones that are hunting other fish or looking for hard things that are on the bottom, like clams and crabs to eat, they'll most likely have teeth in their mouth. Another adaptation that some fish have is they'll have a beak like a parrot, and they'll use that beak just like the octopus does to crack open shells. And then you'll have fish like these guys in here, all the different pumpkin seed and the bass and everybody, they don't really have teeth in their mouth because they don't need them. What they do is they'll wait for the food to come along, and then they'll just open their mouth really quickly. And that acts like a vacuum cleaner, and it sucks the food into their mouth. So they don't really chew their food, they just swallow it whole. So you can see them sucking the food off the bottom.
Yeah. All right, Ben and Calista, I am gonna come to you guys next. You can put your hands down. Ashley, if you do have a question, put up your hand for me, let me know. But I wanted to take a quick question from Esme and Olivia in Guelph. They wanna know where the turtles lay their eggs there, if they do lay any eggs.
Sure, turtles are the same as most reptiles, so they'll lay eggs. And where they lay their eggs is on land. So if they laid their eggs underwater, their eggs would drown, the same as me and you would drown if we stayed underwater for too long. So they don't lay their eggs underwater. They'll go up on land. They'll find some mud. They'll dig a hole in the mud, and then they'll lay their eggs in the mud and then bury it again. And then the eggs are on their own to hatch on their own. They don't stick around to make sure that they hatch.
Awesome. Very cool. We've been covering turtles a lot lately. Actually, we've been doing sessions with the turtle hospital. So if you want to find out more about them, check that out.
Cool.
All right, Bennett, if you have a question, come on up, man.
Well, I think, well, turtles, I know some.
No, put your hand down.
I have a really good question.
Sorry, guys. There we go. Bennett, keep going, buddy.
Well, I know turtles eat carrots and lettuce, and I don't know what the turtles eater eat.
Yeah, what else do turtles eat, Sean?
Sure, turtles will pretty much eat anything that they can find. So some turtles are vegetarian, and they'll eat, for instance, in the oceans, they'll eat seaweed or any of the algae that floats by. And then some turtles are carnivorous, so they'll eat meat. And like our snapping turtle, for instance, will eat fish that happen to swim by. So they'll stay very, very still and they'll wait. And if a fish swims near their mouth, well, they'll just snap out really quickly and catch them that way. So it depends on the species of turtle, but they'll eat a variety of different things. But most of the times, turtles will eat whatever they happen to be able to find.
Fantastic. All right, two quick Slido questions. This has been our most popular question today. When we see salmon in the Credit River in Mississauga, which is right near the Toronto Zoo for people tuning in from around the world, do these salmon come from the ocean or from Lake Ontario?
Yeah, it depends on the type of salmon. They probably came out of Lake Ontario and come up the creeks. And the reason they're doing that and why you see them at certain times of the year is because they're going into their spawning grounds. So usually you'll see these huge salmon that don't look like they belong in these tiny little creeks. And they're doing that because they're swimming up the creek to lay their eggs. And they lay their eggs way up there. When the fry hatch, that's what the baby salmon are called, then they can swim back down the creek into the rivers, then into the lakes and live again. So most likely they're coming out of the Great Lakes.
Awesome, all right. Calista, if you have another question, go for it.
Is it true that eggshell turtles can lay their eggs in an alligator nest?
Yes, yeah, sometimes it's what's known as parasitic nesting. So a lot of different birds will do that. Well, they'll lay their eggs in other birds' nests so that the other birds will raise their babies for them. And it is possible for some turtles down in Florida to find alligator nests and lay their eggs in there as well. Because why wouldn't you? When you have a mom alligator make this enormous nest and then lay her eggs in it, she did it so well that all of what she made the nest out of starts to rot. And when it rots, it heats up. And so what it actually does is incubate the eggs. So the eggs can stay warm when they're inside that nest, as long as that stuff keeps on rotting. And then that helps them to grow up and be healthy. So if you're a turtle, you might as well lay your eggs in the same place, because then you get this really nice nest to take advantage of.
All right, very cool. We've been getting this question from a whole bunch of people on YouTube. It's going to be our last sort of official question, and it's, are piranha vicious? We've heard about piranha being brutal and tearing things apart. Are they scary? Should we be terrified of piranha?
Should we be worried or scared of piranha, you say?
Yeah, are they vicious?
Not really. Piranha look really scary. A lot of animals look really scary, but you always have to remember that us as humans, we're huge compared to a little tiny piranha. So if you ever jump into a river in South America where there happens to be piranha, that I'll almost guarantee that all of the piranha will swim as fast as possible to get away from you, because you're this huge animal that might hurt them. So they're probably more scared of you than you are of them.
Fantastic. I'm always glad we get that message across. So Sean, before we wrap up, where can people at home, our kids joining live, the people on YouTube, on Slido, learn more about what the zoo is doing while no one can actually visit?
Absolutely. So we're having these episodes twice a week, obviously, 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. On top of that, every single episode that we broadcast, we also have resources available that you can download from torontozoo.com. And you can also go back and watch any of the previous episodes as well. On top of all of that, we also have things going on all of our social media platforms, even TikTok. So you can also check out any of those things as well, which includes our daily Keeper Talks. I think those are at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time as well.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much, Sean, for an awesome presentation. Additionally, again, so all those resources can be found on our YouTube channel. I just put in the YouTube chat bar the link to the zoo's additional resources. And if you want to support what we're doing broadly here at Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants, check us out on YouTube, subscribe to us there, check us out on social media. All our sessions are posted, and you can find out how you can get a camera spot too. But now, as we're wrapping up, I just want to give a chance for all the kids joining us live. So that's Becca, Bennett, Ashley, Brandy, Tegan, and Callie. If you guys want to demute your microphones, let me see if I can demute as many as I can. And you guys can give a big thank you to Sean and the Toronto Zoo team for joining us today. Go for it, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right, thanks for joining.
Yeah, it's awesome having some live kids today. We really, really appreciate you tuning in. And again, for everyone at the Zoo team, thank you so much and have a wonderful rest of your day, everyone.
All right, bye. Have a great day. See you soon.